our distinguished speaker and the participant. And now it's the time of the startup of our first technical session. First technical session will be covered by our external resource person, Dr. Hammad Gilani. He is a graduate from Punjab University, and he did his PhD in photogrammetry and remote sensing from School of Geomatics, Lyon Technical Institute, University, China. With this educational background, he has rich working experience with local and international organizations. Presently, he is working as assistant professor, photogrammetry and remote sensing at Institute of Space Technology, Islamabad. Prior to this one, he has been working with ICI mode and WWF. In addition to the working with such organization, he has experiences of working with other international organizations in form of projects such as NASA, FAO, SARC, JAXA, and USAID. With more than 25 publications in journals and book chapters and reports. Now I will hand over to our external resource person, Dr. Hammad Gilani. Topic he will cover: satellite data mining and processing using Google Earth Engine. The normal schedule of this portion will be from 10:30 to 11:30. At the end of the session, we will try to spare 10 to 15 minutes for the questions raised by the participants. If we have more questions, then we can either extend the time or we can note down them and will reply the respondent later on. So with these words, I will hand over the mic to Dr. Hammad Gilani. Dr. Shab, can you listen my voice?
Yes, I can listen you. I hope all of you can listen me very clearly.
Okay, sir. Now, sir, take your seat and carry on.
Thank you so much. And very nice to be connected. And I am really always, this is not a formal statement I'm going to say. This is from my heart. Always I feel honored, privileged whenever Dr. Ghulam Nabi calls me, and he bothers me time to time. And it is not kind of bothering. It is a friendly call. Always he says me, I need this and we can do this thing and we are doing this thing. We collaborate this. So I feel a kind of sitting here, and even sometime I visit your center and part of your team, and same way we are working. So this is kind of, I am very much thankful to Dr. Ghulam Nabi, and particularly under the leadership of Dr. Noor Muhammad Khan Saab. And always I in different forum, whenever he speaks, I try to listen him and grab knowledge, and then accordingly shaping up myself also. So he is doing a great job in very limited resources, in limited team, and in knowledge delivery point of view, he is doing great job. First time I am contact with you, sir. So hopefully we will work together future, inshallah. I hope all of you is there any foreigner among us, or all are Pakistanis? So just let me clarify. So then accordingly, I can sometime can switch from English to Urdu. So this is the one I want to ask. We foreigner hai hum mein ke sare Pakistani hain?
All are Pakistanis. One of them are from Turkey.
Okay, Turkey. So then I have to speak in English. Thank you so much. Great. If you see, the given topic is in terms of the data mining and processing, but I have slightly modified that one. And we are going to talk about the same thing as cloud computing and data access, time series analysis, how we are at the stage where we can get a near real time information. So, but if you see the topic, what I have given is kind of very catchy with the words. Catchy words, because whenever we talk about the settler data, if we talk about settler data, we say, oh, it's a costly. But no, it is not costly. Fine. People know we have a lot of information. If we have a lot of information, then how we can use this information, this data, in terms of a resource optimum way to capitalize in such a way that can be used in a scientific community to address few of the topic that we are covering in terms of climate change, in terms of the water scarcity, in terms of the forest degradation, deforestation, in terms of the urbanization, name it. So everything is in our hand, but the problem is how to access this information, how to use this information in such a way that we can use in economically and ecologically viable solution provide. Like, if we are going to spend the money on the data and processing, and the cost of the data purchasing, processing is much higher than the cost of the overall projects, then it is not going to be success. Yes, one time we can do, but for long term, for sustainability, we need to find out a solution where we can actually grab our data and processing tools. Those can be long running in terms of sustainability, in terms of less human resource required, less machine resources required. So in this time, the era we are living, we have cloud computing technology. Earlier, this was not there. Cloud is just like a machine. In simple terminology, I'm telling, is a machine like in front of us, either desktop or a laptop. But it has more power. It has all the information already stored. So in this way, we don't need to download the data on our machines like computer and laptop, or we don't need to process on locally on our machines. So whatever we are doing on cloud. The same thing what we were doing on our computer, we are doing on a cloud. Cloud is a server. We get access to our username and login credentials.
Sorry to disturb, sir.
Yes, yes.
So your slides are not moving.
Oh, I'm not moving. Now.
Okay. Sorry,
I'm not moving. I'm just giving introduction. At the moment, I'm giving you the background. So then we will learn one page, and accordingly I will move. So,
okay, thank you.
So the point right now is, the question comes here, either if I'm going to use cloud computing technology, my credentials are, my security is a questionable or not. Yes, your all the data, your all the processing are intact. It is not going to be useful, or it is not going to be visible to others, or it is not going to be accessible to others. Just like our Google Cloud, our Dropbox, or some other drive where we are keeping our data, until and unless we give access to others. So this is the concept of cloud. Globally, now people are moved from desktop to cloud because they don't want to invest the money, energy, and as well as their time on downloading and processing the data on their desktop. So they are shifted from desktop to the cloud. So this is the basic concept, and where we have all data mining tools are there. We have big geospatial data. All of you are very much familiar with number of the satellite existing. Like if you talk about the Landsat program, all of you are familiar. If we talk about the MODIS, all of you are familiar. It's a daily data is providing. It is providing us number of products, either that could be used for agriculture, water, forestry, even for different kind of other our purposes, like a kind of if we want to go for flood mapping and drought mapping. Well, I will show you a couple of these examples what I'm talking about using these cloud computing technology. So Here, if you see, we have number of satellites, and number of satellites are being used in different applications. But now, the thing is where we are standing. Most of us, but it is like kind of most of us. When I say it means that the more than 50% people still are using the smaller area and doing a lot of geoprocessing data analysis on their desktop. So now we have to overcome this. We have to move from desktop to the cloud. How? It is very easy. It is not going to be change the basic concept. Only the concept we have to build ourselves. We have to come out of our comfortable zone and to learn a little bit programming. And programming these days is not very difficult as because a lot of information is already available on internet, and we are not code programmers. This is not our domain, but what we can do is we can learn slightly little bit programming. That I will show you a couple of examples. It is not going to be very difficult when I will show you, and you say, oh, this is a very easy, I can even try myself. And the second thing is you can get the code already existing. You can customize and modify according to your need and your requirement and your area, and then accordingly get your findings and your result on your desired area. And most importantly, if let's say one day one of your supervisor or boss is saying you please do analysis for one of the area, let's say I say Balochistan. So one day you are sitting and you are doing all the process, let's say he says to you please kindly bring a land surface temperature time series analysis. So it means that you are going to process like in last 20 years or 30 years land surface temperature over the Balochistan and getting the result. Okay, and next day when you go and you say, okay, this is my result, these are the results I have produced based on your instruction. And he says, oh, now what if we include the SIN also? That time you will be worried. Oh, again, I have to process the data. Again, I have to get the result for other area. It is will be difficult for me. But now with the cloud computing technology, and this is also very easy. Only what we have to do is, what we do, we actually shift our study area from one place to other place, and even we can change the time interval and get the result very quickly. And because we have already wrote and we have already designed our program, we have already, our codes are running in such a way that those are not very static kind of code. Those are dynamic codes. So this is the beauty. If someone is developing, sitting in America for his own purpose and sharing, and this is again the thing is, most of the codes and tools and data products are freely available. So open access is this one of the advantage. That's why they are using this for societal benefit and to scientific interest for the larger community. This is also not right now a constraint. So now we are also a part of this community, and sitting here in Pakistan, we have produced a couple of example. Like I can show you example of this is the one of the example, global drought mapping and monitoring. This is produced sitting in Pakistan, and one of my student she produced three papers on drought because she has access of data. She has access to the algorithm. So only the thing is, she just need to sit and slightly concentrate and bring something out of the box that other people are not doing. So same thing is we can do. So this is a one of the examples. So this is now the time where we have to move from desktop. We have to move from very smaller area, very limited products to the larger area for societal benefit and to bring the for the scientific community. Last but not the least, one of the main advantage when we are doing on cloud data computing, we are doing processing. We can share our information to public. How? This is the now the time where we have to disseminate our information to others. So right now we have the leverage, we have the facility where we can actually produce our apps. These are just like other web apps, what we are looking, web GIS and other stuff. So this is also giving us the facility where we can actually produce near real-time processing and get the results. So here, this is one of the example. You can see drought monitoring system. So in this, if you see, one of the example here is from Sri Lanka, another one is from India. So only we can get actually the result on our dashboard without looking the code. So code is behind this one. So if you are going to show someone these kind of products, so we need a data dissemination through different means. Like either we have to, we are belong to scientific community, so we actually love to write a scientific article. We love to write the blogs. We love to communicate in a printed or electronic media. But at the same time, if you want to project your result, your data sets to the larger community, those who are not interested in a reading, but are interested towards a the actual visualization, so we can build actually a web app. I will stop here. If you have any question up to here, so you can ask then accordingly, or you can post in what will be the mod here. I am not quite sure. They will ask the question at the end or between they can ask in between they can intervene. कैसे होगा कि ये क्वेश्चन दरमियान पूछ सकते हैं या आखिर में पूछेंगे
कैसे यस सर इफ एनीवन हैव एनी क्वेश्चन दे कैन राइज देयर हैंड्स
ओके ओके सो प्लीज फील फ्री इफ यू हैव एनी क्वेश्चन एज पर द मॉडरेटर सो यू कैन हैंड रेज एंड ही विल अलाउ यू टू कम इन एंड कैन स्पीक एंड कैन टॉक और यू कैन राइट योर क्वेश्चन सो आई नो ऑल ऑफ यू आर will have not similar knowledge, similar background. So in this case, if you want to ask a question, please feel free. Okay. So now what we have in our hand in terms of the cloud computing, in terms of big geospatial data analysis, we have number of platforms existing around us. The only the thing is, it's our interest how we are going to access. Okay, let me give you an example. Like if you say Microsoft Azure, it is available. So if someone is interested, so they can get their credentials, login, and they can actually register and can use their platform. Like Amazon is also providing us web services. So only the thing is they are charging a little bit penny of kind of so this is the another small disadvantage for developing countries. So they are asking for credit card information. So most of us don't have credit card information. So we normally don't opt this services. So Sentinel Hub is there. Like I will show you example of Sentinel 5P. You all, most of us are sitting in Lahore, and the Lahore condition is getting worse day by day due to smoke, and we have seen in the past years too. So this way, Sentinel is providing us a range of the satellite data. Among them is Sentinel 5P. Sentinel 5P providing us number of atmospherically prudent information like NO2, CO, ozone, and this information, SO2. So this these information we can, how we can use and can get the in real time result, and accordingly we can take a decision. Among all these big geospatial data analysis platform, we are going to talk a little bit more today on Google Earth Engine. Why? As we all are aware, the Google has a range of products, range of platforms, and it has a huge community, user community, either Gmail, Google Earth, our pro, where we are interacting with high resolution data. We are actually looking some of the our site specific information, our surrounding areas, and when we are moving computing from one platform one place to other place, we are always using the Google Map and navigator. So Google is providing us ranges of apps. And so now one of the example is here, we have in terms of processing big geospatial data is Google Earth Engine platform. It's a simple, very simple platform. It is, it has a large community. Let me open this, sir. Minute, I think I am admin, so I'm getting a lot of requested. So that's why, my intention diverted. Okay, where I was. Let me bring one. Please excuse me. So let me figure out the thing. Okay. What is actually Google Earth Engine? So first we will introduce, I will introduce you the engine itself, and then I will move toward some of the apps. So hopefully I will try to give you a flavor. Yes, I may not able to go into very details programming stuff, but yes, I will try to give you such a flavor that maybe among all of you, 50% may be interested to learn more and to opt this one and to use for your own daily processing stuff. Of I know all of you are looking in terms of, and Dr. Lu mentioned about the data, remote sensing data is also one of the area where we get a lot of near real-time information that can be used in different applications of hydrology, water resources, and land resource management and stuff. So, and Indian actually, this concept is started almost 12 years back, and that time Child Good Child is one of the lead author of this title, this paper. This is called Next Generation Digital Earth. What he says the supply of geographic information, okay, this is information from satellite-based and ground-based sensors has expanded rapidly, encouraging belief in new fourth for our big data paradigm of science that emphasizes on what thing? International collaboration, data-intensive analysis, huge computing resources, and high-end visualization. This statement he gave almost 10 years back. So right now, this particular statement is very much true, and we are applying this in our scientific community. We, due to this next generation digital earth, as we have the platforms I will show you, these are the servers they have installed, and these, due to these servers and this platform, we are right now connected internationally. We are collaborating among ourselves. We have a lot of data, and name it, like all of you are familiar, we have the MODIS daily data. And MODIS is giving us daily terra and aqua data, and we have a lot of products based on that one. And all of you are familiar, like if you are going for some of the hydrological evapotranspiration or some other stuff, so most of you are using. So we have the Landsat data, we have Sentinel data, we have weather data, we have the climatic data set, we have other byproducts available. Let me give you the example. Just last week, 20th of this month, ESA released 10 meter global land cover products at 10 meter using the Sentinel 1 and Sentinel 2. And can you imagine what they have done? They have put the data on their server with a dedicated visualization platform, as well as they also have integrated their data in an engine. So Why? Because Indian had its own flexibility and people are using among all these platforms what I talk. So they prefer the Indian because the user community of Google Earth Engine is more than anyone else. But I'm not undermining others. So maybe they have the other advantages, but the best advantage that the in terms of the usage, the engine is at the moment is on high rank. So all the satellites are there. So this is the statement of Google. So we have to understand to organize the world information, make it universally accessible and useful. How? I will go through a couple of examples. So one thing is need to understand this is the actually the front view of Indian. I will show you here. Let me come to I can bring in front of you. You can see this one, all of you. If I open code.earthengine.google, so we have these small windows. Simple is not a very tricky job to understand. This area is to write the code. Simple. If we are writing, let's say first we will go to Versa. We say modest land fish temperature. So you have this setup as this, all of you are familiar. This is a very much common kind of data. That's why I'm searching this thing. So the modest land, terra land surface temperature, emissivity, daily global 1 kilometer. So this actually data is available from, let me go this one to open this here. So then I can explain in a better way. So if you see in terms of the time data availability, it is available from 2000 March 05-03 means 5th of March 2000 till 19th of October 2021. So it means that this data is almost near real time and it has spatial resolution of 1 kilometer. Okay, again I'm getting a lot of requests. This is giving alerts to me, so that's why I divert my focus. So sorry for this. So if you see, this is the land surface temperature daily 1 kilometer. It has spatial resolution 1 kilometer and it is giving us Kelvin. So this simple data is available. So when I open this data and it is giving me here the description and how I can cite this data, and it is the citation is there. And if you see here, it is written explore in Earth Engine, open in code editor. Simply, I'm just clicking here and opening in a new window. And let's compute. I'm running. So you see here it is written. So if I explain you this simple code, so first thing is, sorry, we have to understand this is actually the data path where it is stored. So simple is snippet. Snippet is we have here. It is stored in this particular link. If we are opening this link here, we can actually filter the data according to the date, according to our study area, and this we can define. And again, if I'm talking about the data set, it has two bands, not the spectral band, but it is given as the name of bands. So band we need is land surface temperature, LST underscore day underscore 1 kilometer, not the QC underscore day. So it is defining here that land surface temperature is equal to data this particular day time. So in based on this thing, we are defining that in this time interval, the data stored in this link should be given to this particular variable named as a dataset. And dataset is stored now, land surface temperature, LST underscore data underscore 1 kilometer is the spectral band in terms of, it's a band. So now in terms of I'm giving spectral because most of us are familiar with the spectral band. So band is a generic terminology. So we are selecting these things and these are the our visualization parameters, the minimum value, maximum value, and as I mentioned, the unit is Kelvin. So Kelvin, and then these are the color ranges. So map center is to zoom particular area, and then we can map actually map dot add layer. As most of us are familiar with GIS software, so like ArcMap, QGIS, on there, whenever we have to open the data. We have to add the layer. So here we are adding map.add layer, land surface temperature, and its visualization parameters and name. So now let's see if I want to inspect the land surface temperature within this time period, and it gives me actually this information in Kelvin 15605 number in Kelvin land surface temperature. Let me change and say I want to, it's a mean value of 2021. It is quickly computing this thing and giving me results. See this, how quickly it came up. So this is the beauty of the now Earth engine. So if you want to know more about the data catalog, you can go to the Earth engine data catalog, and with the name or with other tags you can search. If you are interested in climate and weather, so like a kind of climate data what exists in this one. So if you see Sentinel-5P cloud data is there. So simple way is, in terms of visualization, the code is available here. But for processing, we need more kind of advanced programming skills. So that I'm talking about a little bit afterwards. So it give me slightly more time to explain you in engine how we are using in Pakistan and how you can use in your field. So if you have any question up to here, please feel free to ask, then accordingly I can proceed. Any question?
You can raise your hand. We can unmute your mics. Participants, if you have any question, you can raise your hands. We can unmute your mics to ask a question to our resource person. Sir, I think there is no question. So, okay. And so second thing, you do not have required to admit anyone. We will admit it in participant list. You just carry on.
Okay, thanks. This is a very, very big favor for me. This is, thank you. I'm very much thankful because this was diverting my attention. So I am very much thankful. Okay, so coming to now moving how we are using in Pakistan and how you can use in your field. So
I think there is a one question from,
yes, please,
sorry,
please.
I'm
yes, please.
Ubaid Khalid, you can ask a question. Okay, sir, please carry on, sir. I think he is not
interested. Okay, thank you so much. So how we are using in Pakistan, and these are some of the limbs from past capacity building platform, even I'm also offering one a complete semester course and workshop. So you can see some time back in time of the when I think it was 2019, if I'm not wrong, Dr. Ghulam Nabi can actually give us exact date. So this is the time when I came and introduced almost 1 day session in your center. So to give hands-on on Google Earth Engine. So I am very much interested in that, as I mentioned. And apart from this one, I am also conducting a couple of trainings and workshops in different platforms. So this is the one of the example when we have actually started in Pakistan using Indian and for the scientific communication. So one of my student, she is Ramla Khan. Now she's doing PhD from Open University in UK. So she has taken a very small area. This is a Portwar plateau. So he has computed different drought indices. Among them is VCI, vegetation condition index, TCI, temperature condition index, PDSI is precipitation drought severity index. So if you see, this is a whole kind of methodological flowchart diagram, and these are the products. And how quickly she has developed, she has worked just, I think, 3 months, and she produced these results, and accordingly, she communicated in a peer-reviewed article. And later on, she figured out, why not? I should take up this method to the global scale and come out as a one scientific paper as well as a dashboard. So this is the one of the example of the in terms of the drought, and all of you are student of hydrology and must be interested to know about the drought. So I can share with you in terms of temperature, vegetation, and if you are interested more in hydrological drought, so you can conclude in the engine. So in terms of the vegetation, again, as all of us very much aware about, the rice required a lot of water. Evapotranspiration point of view, how much the kind of evapotranspiration is happening and what kind of fluxes are going on. And these kind of analysis we can do a quick way using the time series analysis data and spatially distribution. And this is one of the example in terms of rice crop mapping, phenology drive from Sentinel-2 at 10 meter resolution. And here my student actually used in-situ measurements, like he's from the Gujranwala district, so actually he collected a lot of field data, and he actually integrated with the Sentinel-2 data, 10 meters spatial resolution, and came up of this particular map as well as the phenology. So this is the important thing, is to understand the health of the of any plot. Like here we have the rice. So here I am also giving you an example of few of the example, like if you are interested more on Sentinel-1. So again, using the time series analysis, using the historic data and backscattering information, you can plot and actually come up as a result. So because as most of you are the student of water related field, so the radar data, SAR data is very much in the water field in terms of hydrological, because it's sensitive, it has a penetration and can give us kind of much accurate finding than optical remote sensing data set. So if you see like example of the rice, and it has gone phenological stages as compared to tree, water and rice. And here you can see the water is was having earlier the higher side of the backscattering values, and now it's 1. So this is these kind of analysis we do very quickly in engine. I will show you the examples couple of. And if we are talking about lot about the billion tree tsunami plantation, so this is another example, near real time example. Only the thing is to extract the information, get result and then accordingly communicate. So these are the some of the graphs. So here, this is the forest fire related example. Most of you are not. The one of the example is maybe you will be interested in terms of the mangrove. So mangrove has its unique characteristic, and only it exists along the coastline. And Pakistan is fortunate enough. We have the right now here you have a map of 5 sites, but now we have 8 sites where mangrove exists. So we have done analysis from last 30 years data based on Landsat data, and we have communicated, and it has gone at wider audience and acceptability is very high. It has gone up to the prime minister level. Like in our Pakistan, the mangrove cover has increased. So this is the one of the biggest advantage in the favor of Pakistan to get the financial resources in terms of the performance based mechanism. If you are interested, your work is more towards the water. If you are interested, you can go and can have a water quality analysis. If you're interested, you can come up as a how the sea land intrusion is happening based on the time series analysis. So these are just few of the example I am giving. So it's up to you how you can take up and you can use in your scientific work. Now I will move towards us on how we are doing the time series analysis. If you see the time series analysis, here we have a number of type of charts. I will go through a couple of examples. Like if you see, if you want to compare two sites on one graph, you don't need to download the data, you don't need to compute the resources and to utilize your resources, machine resources, your time on and you, on your like a daily as we are doing. So we actually can do this work on a quickly basis. I will show you the example of here. I have already examples, so but I may not able to give you the, all the, but as this is a introductory webinar, so hopefully you will able to how quickly we can do analysis. So you see, I have just already written the code. So this writing code is not a problem, because it needs your intention in terms of basic remote sensing, understanding of Earth observation data, and then we can teach you in terms of the program. So you see how quickly it has taken up the data. And if you want to change these parameters, I will change in front of you. Let's say I want to change time. If you want to 2010 and up to 2020, and we are having 10, okay. This can be. Let's see how quickly we get the result. Meanwhile, I will show you that. We can actually download the data itself if we are satisfied enough. And we want to prepare the maps, and we want to put in our reports. Like this is the one of the example in terms of the temperature on Jordan. This is a small country. This is a one of the examples. So what actually these maps show us? So 2000, this is a mean temperature of 2000, and similarly up to 2019. This is a slightly old work, so then it is up to 2019. Otherwise, I could have put 2020 and 2021. So temperature in centigrade. So these kind of maps, we can actually download the actual data in raster format, and then we can prepare the maps either in ArcMap in R. So I'm using the R. So same way is like, this is the enhanced vegetation index, and this is the normalized difference and gross primary productivity. So you see, it is not the only you can compute the graphical analysis. You can also compute the spatial analysis, and you can download the data in your hard disk. But we are not downloading actual raster data. We are downloading always a product. Those products could be used for decision making and would be having a less size as compared to actual data. If I talk about giving you an example, if we have the one Landsat scene, its size is nearly 1 GB. But if we compute on based on 1 GB NDVI, its size is a couple of KBs. So we are interested more in the products rather than actual data. So this is the thing. Another, we actually can download the data, and you see this is the example. I was showing you this one, and within the 2 or 3 minutes it came up. So if either I have to download the data or then process. The second option I have is cloud. And on the cloud, if you have seen how quickly I have received and I have seen the data results. So this is the biggest advantage in terms of the data computing and to get the near real time result. Like if I want to compare these two sites, but over the year, like if this is the year-wise, if we compare, this is called the day of the year series by region. So it means that here we have the time, long time, but if we want to see in a particular year how these are behaving, so this is the day-wise we can compute. And similarly, we can produce number of type of crops, name it. So we have lot of information, lot of data is there, only it is up to us how we are going to use these data sets and these kind of algorithm in our favor. Like most of us are very much familiar about the machine learning algorithms, data mining. So how quickly we can get results. Like I can give you the example of, let's say, a forest above ground biomass. So this code is written for the forest above ground biomass mapping, but this could be used for the crop yield mapping. This could be used for the water quality monitoring. What we need actually the sum of the in-situ measurement and linking with the satellite data and in putting the cloud computing technology and data mining techniques. One of the example is we have the Smile Random Forest. Similarly, we have a number of other algorithms like the decision tree. We have minimum distance is there, Bayesian is there. Again, we have spectral region is there, max size modeling is there. So name it. So we have most of the data mining tools are there, algorithms are there, and only the thing is we have to define our objectives and accordingly use these tools, data and methods in our favor for the scientific community to present in a much efficient and quick manner. Thank you so much. If you have any question, please feel free. I have spare 15 minutes. If you want to ask any question, please, most welcome, come up. Please don't hesitate because maybe I will learn more things from if you ask me question. So then it will be also in my favor to learn more about your field, and then accordingly I can shape up my discussion.
Okay, anyone have any question? They can raise their hand. Okay. Izaz, kindly allow Tahseen Zulfikar. Tahseen Zulfikar, you can unmute your own mic and ask a question.
First of all, thank you very much, sir, for this conference. Sir, I have a question about being a new user of satellite data. How we can confident about the hydrology results? Any solution or methodology, please suggest recommended.
This is a very generic question, if I understand. I hope I am actually again telling you I'm not an expert in hydrology, but yes, I can use confidently different remote sensing data sets in terms of the hydrology assessment, as I have shown you the couple of data sets. Whenever we use any method, or the data, we always looking in terms of scientific their contribution. As I mentioned, few of the data sets, they have also given the citation of their products. So if you are more interested in terms of understanding how much accurate their data is and how much I will get in terms of when I'm going to use for my particular area in different fields. So you can go through there and then accordingly report the allowable error. So this is the right answer, but whenever we are doing any kind of scientific work, either in hydrology or the other land resources point of view, we always look in terms of the error budgeting. And so without error budgeting, it is difficult to exactly answer how much you will be accurate. In few of the modeling techniques, you will be very much accurate. Like I can give you the example here. I have computed this code. And if I see here, it is giving me the error of 40% only confidence on my results. It has the 144. Root mean square error. It doesn't mean it is inaccurate. Only the matter is how I am again further improving this thing. Similarly, in hydrology field also, you will see actually that parallel to your work, other people have done our similar work or some findings there. So then accordingly, you can compare your results as well as your accuracy with them, and then accordingly report. So this is the indirect answer, but giving direct answer is at the moment is hard for me, because unless we go and can find out more into the site specific and data specific and modeling specific results.
Thank you very much, sir. I have one more question.
Yes, please.
I'm using GCM data for future hydrological response of a basin. The GCM precipitation data statistic with observed one is just satisfactory. How we can improve GCM precipitation data?
I think Dr. Noor, I think can answer in a better way on this, because again, as I mentioned, I am not kind of hydrology and future prediction point of view expert. So Dr. Noor, please, over to you.
I would like to add to what Dr. Hamad has told you, that we test the errors. In modeling, it is our standard practice that we use certain data. First, we carry out data analysis, and we see its ranges, its mean value. Then we carry out consistency test. We check it against a group of other station data. So if you are using the satellite data, and if it is a new product, better is that you first compare it with some standardized data like ground-based data. In the remote sensing, we say this, sometimes only if you are, for example, seeing the land use spectrum, if you are using the land coverage data, you go for ground truthing first. So this is very important. Testing question was important. So otherwise, it will be garbage in and garbage out. So we have to avoid that. Whenever we have to use a new data set, a new source of data, first we check it. Either through ground truthing or from getting a comparison with the observed data at the ground, and then we see its precision and its accuracy. For example, people have been using SRTM data quite frequently, SRTM data with respect to elevation. But if you go to their website, they will tell you that they have an error of of meters in their elevation. They are trying to improve it with the gears passing on, but we have to be familiar with their limitations. They are not, for example, for rainfall, they are not measuring on the ground. They are seeing the clouds at the top. From the clouds and from the temperature data, they are putting some mathematical equation and converting it to the rain estimate. So we should not expect they are as accurate as the ground-based data, but they are an additional source of knowledge. So first we have to check it against our valid observed data, whatever the source may be. It can be your field observation, for example, for land cover. For rainfall, it should be your meteorological station data. And then you can, your second question was for GCM data, how can I correct it? Hopefully, Dr. Mansoor will be talking about applying bias correction on your satellite space data. Hopefully, we will be talking about it because he's one of the experts of that. And we apply then certain calibration factor or biasness correction factor to make it more close to our ground-based data. So that is what I think Kathleen was asking, and we have to carry out data analysis. Simply using them is one part of the solution. Second part is validating them, making it plausible, making it possible. So that is quite important. In that, your sense of modeling, sense of knowledge of the hydrology will come into play. Hopefully I answered the question, Kathleen.
Yes, sir, thank you, got it.
Dr. Hamad can add to it, and Dr. Masood can also add to it.
Thank yes, you. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Whatever you are saying is perfect.
Okay.
As I mentioned, hand cover data, this is one of the important different modeling techniques models. So, recently, the ESA released 10 meter land cover globally, and they have reported only the 70% accuracy at the global level. In our part of the world, South Asia, they are reporting 80%. So, as per their statistical, this is the information they are reporting the accuracy. Now it is up to us if we want to use that data, and we need to check actual ground information and validate, and then accordingly we'll be confident enough to fully use and then accordingly report our finding to the local and the scientific community, and globally that will be acceptable. So these are the limitation in whenever we use any kind of data in any field. So this is the we have to address accordingly.
Okay, sir, we have another question. Dr. Muhammad Ashraf has raised his hand. Muhammad Ashraf, you can unmute your own mic to ask a question. Muhammad Ashraf, are you listening? Okay. Anyone have any question other than Muhammad Ashraf, because he is not responding? Okay, I think, sir, there is no other question. Okay, thank you very much, sir. Dr. Hamad Gilani, your lecture was very interactive and very learned. I would like to invite our...
Thank you so much, ji. Allah Hafiz. Bahut acha laga.
Thank you so much, sir, for your time.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.